Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, folks. It is Monday, and it is the start of our expert series, and we always start hot with Mr. Greg Dickerson. How you doing, sir?
Doing great, Michael. How about you?
I'm doing well, man. I really look forward to all three of these conversations today. Conversation one is going to be about a housing slowdown. Number two is going to be about the dollar and why people need to start paying attention. And then number three is, what's going to impact on housing if the stock market crashes or corrects? So again, three topics, folks, that you're certainly going to want to listen to today. But Greg, first and foremost, just so I don't forget, how can people get a part of your world? Because you give so much back to the One Rental at a Time family.
Yeah. The easiest way to track me everywhere is gregdickerson.com. All my social media links are there. I have a YouTube channel, podcast, all over Instagram, Twitter, whatever. Everything is there.
Awesome, man. I appreciate it. And check him out. He's doing amazing stuff, helping lots of people. And I'll say this. He is helping people. Just if you've seen his interviews, and he's got hundreds of hours on this channel, he just thinks different than most of us, including myself. It's amazing. I'm so glad he's part of this circle. He's improved my investing. So go check him out.
Thank you, Mike. Appreciate that.
Oh, of course. The first thing I want to talk about is, I know YouTube University is making people think a real estate crash is coming. We've talked about endlessly. One is not coming, in my opinion. But
this year. So this year. Remember, everybody was calling for, you know, a crash by the end of 2021. And I put a video out the other day about that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, specifically and citing statistically why that's not going to happen this year. But I'm not saying a crash can't happen at some point. We've talked about that. But the specific call was by the end of 2021, housing was going to crash.
Not going to happen. Not going to happen. Just mathematically impossible at this point. That said, I know crash videos get content, but we're here to create opportunity for folks. So what I think is already happening in many markets and will happen in more markets is housing is going to go through a slowdown. We have seen, perhaps, at least in my 20 years, the greatest seller's market the last 14 months. Junk was going at retail, 10, 15, 20% over asking was not crazy. So I think there's a slowdown afoot, so much so that I've created what I call a housing slowdown bingo card with 10 metrics. And I want to share that with you just to see what you think of these 10. The idea in these 10 is every market is different. As we've talked about many, many times, housing is hyper-local. We talk about housing, generally speaking, usually at a North America level or a US level. But everybody should look at this bingo card and ask them about their market. So you got a chance to look at this, or do you have time to look at this? I'll bring it up.
Yeah. Let's take a look at it.
All right. So again, this was something I did. It's funny. I was working out yesterday and this idea came to me and I just had to send myself a note. So we're going to go through the template and then I'll bring up my market of Fresno in a minute. So again, I think there are 10 variables. Again, I'm happy to change these, Greg, if you think any of them are kind of off, but I'm going to just start in the first column, right? Or cell B2. The first thing I think people are going to see is new listings. They start getting between 0 and 3 offers within a 3-day period, right? I think over the last 14 months, it's not been abnormal for offers, 10, 15, 20 in a very short window. I think we'll go one by one. So what do you think about that?
So what is D, what is O?
I don't know yet. It's just do the work.
Oh, okay.
2 times 5 is 10.
Okay. So these are just 10 things that for what? What are you saying? That there's a slowdown?
Yeah. These are 10 variables that.
Okay.
The reason I pulled this up, right, is do the work is a thing that I say all the time. It's called homework, daily execution. That's where that comes from. Okay. But I was thinking about what things could my students follow every day that might be different in their markets.
Okay. How to spot a slowdown when it's coming. Yeah. And what spurred it. So let's talk about first what drove it through the roof and why are we at all time high demand? Number one, low interest rates. First and foremost, it's all about the payments. Mm-hmm. It's all about interest rates. When you reach a point where it's cheaper to buy than it is to rent, that, generates a lot of demand. Number two, millennials growing up, having families, they want to have home ownership. Number three, the pandemic drove people out of big cities into rural areas and resort type communities. Mm-hmm. And, number four, there's tax benefits and incentives that, first time home buyer programs, things like that may or may not go away. So that's why we are where we are right now. All time high demand for housing, no inventory, because again, people weren't moving a lot because of the pandemic. They didn't want to sell, didn't have to move for jobs, things like that. And sellers that were thinking about it and had so much equity in their house, you know, their options are limited. Where are they going to go if they sell? So that kind of creates a inventory dilemma, and the builders can't keep pace, can't build fast enough. So we all know that story in terms of, you know, being able to deliver units, they can't keep up with the demand. So that's why we are where we are. So how do we spot a slowdown?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. So the first, again, these, and again, in each, folks, these are not things that will go the same in every market. Every market is different. Every market has different variables. It's just the idea that as you start to see some of these, and again, I will go through Fresno in the next slide just to show you what I look at every day. Everybody should do their own. I really believe different markets will see different things first. But once you start to cover this, it'll be a clear sign that the seller's market is over and buyers have at least a little bit more power in the system because they haven't the last 12 months or so. So one of those variables may not be first, but one of the variables I think is new listings will be less hot. Right. There's been a lot of demand out of the gate. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, people get concerned if they don't get showings and offers in the first day right now. So, yeah, that's a good indicator. If you're not getting offers on day one, then something's up.
Exactly. Number two, I've already started to hear this from some agents across the country. And some of this just might be the traditional summer slowdown, or it could be buyer fatigue, or it could be something even worse. But open houses will get less traffic.
Right. Yep. Same thing. Less people out looking and shopping, which we've already seen that because buyers are getting frustrated because they're losing. So they're just saying, you know what? I'm just going to sit it out for a while.
Yeah. I'm going to sit it out. I'm going to go enjoy my summer vacation. We are absolutely seeing stuff like that. Next up, I think, again, as the market transitions, this may be one of the first things, maybe one of the last things that changes, but bidding wars will start to cap out at maybe 10% on the best properties. I think bidding wars will eventually stop on most properties, but the best ones, we're going to start to see a cap because right now some of them are pretty crazy.
Yeah. Most of the stuff that I've seen, people are putting 10% limits on their upward escalation clauses anyway. So yeah, that's the escalation clause going away is the first sign. And then, you know, no contingencies, no inspections going away. That second sign, things like that.
Right. Then what we're going to see really as inventory starts to pile up is the ridiculously low days on market in most markets will start to rise. And I'm going to put a 25% on that, right? We're not, but again, 25% is really not that bad. If you're in a market where days on market's 14, 25% is like 2.5 days.
What if days on market is 6 hours?
Yeah, exactly. Right. Well, they don't.
0.25. Exactly. So, and for people that don't know, haven't been in the market, haven't followed it.
Yeah.
The national average days on market used to be 180. Mm. So anywhere between 120 and 180 days on market, that's 4 to 6 months on the market without selling used to be normal and it used to be average. If you sold in less than 4 months, that was a hot market. If it took you a little longer than 6 months, that was over. When I was building the bulk of my spec houses and flipping houses, it was 6 to 9 months for my houses to sell after they were finished. So this is a very different expectation than we're in right now. And it really cracks me up when I see people put their house on the market now and they're like, you know, 30 days in and they're not selling and they're all frustrated and they're mad at their realtor. And I'm like, look, you got to remember a normal market's about 4 months.
Yeah. So maybe I should change this to 50%. We'll do that.
Yeah. I think it's going to take a little more than 25 because we are just, it's just a false sense of reality right now where we're at with the demand.
Perfect. Thank you for that. This is why I wanted to go over this with somebody else who's in the game like me. Next, what I believe is going to really start to happen and why I think investors and my students and our students will do a lot better is we're going to start to see price drops on junk because right now in my market, it's getting retail. I think we're going to start to see that gap, that widening of the risk profile, right? Still perfect. We'll still sell the best locations, the best house. But I do think we're going to start to see a gap widen on junk.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah. That's, you know, you'll see bad properties sitting longer and prices dropping.
Exactly. All right. Again, so these are just 10 variables, folks, that you need to be watching. Again, I talk about doing the work daily, 20 minutes a day. These are things you will start to see. So we'll go down to listings growing weekly. That's a big one for me.
Yeah. And the easiest way to see that, if you're in an area where real estate signs are allowed, you'll see signs popping up more and more. You'll see them staying longer. So that's the first easiest way to spot it. The other way is to set Zillow alerts and track days on Zillow and things like that. And if you have an agent working with you, they track days on market. But, you know, that's key. Days on market and inventory levels of houses for sale, available for sale, and how many are closing. That's a huge, huge ratio to watch.
Absolutely.
Absorption rate.
There you go. Absorption rate. That's a good metric. The next one is we are going to start to see that gap widen. And I believe investors are going to be able to make profits. I haven't seen a good deal, for example, from a wholesaler in 14 months,
yeah.
14 or 15 months. We are going to see that junk is sitting, as you said, longer.
Yeah.
And when you take junk and a need to sell, that timing pressure will allow us to create opportunities where we can actually add value and make profits and find good deals. So I think the spread's going to widen. And when you do that into a slowing market, sometimes sellers will take, you know, very creative or lower offers.
Yeah, exactly. And retail buyers, you know, that are dealing with and putting up with fixer uppers now because they have no other choice will have more choices.
Exactly. As you said earlier, I did put this in here. Buyers are going to stop waiving inspections and appraisal conditions. Those will suddenly come back to the fold and be a part of normal contracts.
Yep.
Absolutely. Then we have sellers. Believe this or not, I believe what will eventually happen is sellers will have to drop prices to match appraisals. Right now, we're talking 8, 10, 20 grand over, you know, cushions. That will go away and sellers will have a choice, either relist or match appraisals. What do you think?
Right.
Awesome. And then the last one we talked about this is new construction, right? A lot of these first 9 variables have all been existing home sales or used, right? Used homes. We're going to start seeing new construction, not sell out releases in a weekend.
Yeah.
You know, these are all signs that the market is slowing down. And again, it's not a sign of crash. It's just a sign of Uber seller market slowly transitioning to a balanced, and who knows, maybe a buyer's market. But again, this will take time. This will take months. The big thing you got to understand about real estate is its price elasticity is sticky. It doesn't react in minutes or seconds like crypto. It doesn't act in days and weeks like stocks. It's slower, but if you're paying attention every day, you can see these things. So how do you think of these? What do you think of these 10?
Yeah, I think it's great. And I think, you know, real estate can move fast now, much faster than it has in the past, because interest rates are moving very quickly these days. And you'll see that in mortgage applications. If rates tick up 0.5%, mortgage applications are instantly down. If it goes down, they're instantly up. And a lot of it's refi, you know, activity as well. But the market nowadays can change much faster than it used to be able to change. And I mean, literally almost overnight. So we're kind of, this is June, what's the today, the
21st
of June, 2021. Hey, 21.
There you go.
So what typically happens in most areas of the country as we go into the summer, real estate markets will slow down because everybody's traveling,
yep.
Taking time, especially coming off the pandemic, things like that. There's uncertainty in terms of who's going to have to go back to work in the fall when all the, you know, restrictions are completely lifted everywhere, things like that. So we still have a little bit of uncertainty there in terms of what the employment outlook is going to look like from your physical location. And a lot of companies are telling people, hey, if you can go out to the movies, you can go to a restaurant, you can come to the office.
Yeah.
So we're going to see a change of attitude in terms of companies allowing people to work remote when they're paying for office space and people are going out in public elsewhere. So that's number one, that can affect, you know, things as we get back into the fall. And then typically, you know, you see a little bit of a, you know, a little bit of a bounce maybe in the fall, but depending on interest rates, the last time we saw a huge change in the housing market, and I mean, it was instantly, was the fall of 2019. Yeah, fall of 2019, rates went up, the housing market took a nosedive. And I mean, it was crickets, you know, everywhere across the country, everybody was like really concerned. And it was just because of a point or two, you know, I think it was a point and a half increase in interest rates that just shut it off, like literally overnight. So it can happen, and it can happen quickly, especially when you're in a, you know, a summer season when, you know, people are less likely to buy, less interested. They're doing other things. They're not going to open houses because there's nothing else to do and, you know, things like that. So I would just watch that. The other thing is there's a narrative out there that the institutional investors, BlackRock and all that, are buying up all the houses. And that's why there's no inventory.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's not the case either, or that they're driving hot prices up and they're paying whatever for houses. And, you know, that's just not true. They've got formulas that they have to follow that, you know, it's got to make sense. It has to work, you know, in a certain range, but they are buying a lot of houses. A lot of them are new construction subdivisions that are built specifically for that purpose. So from a builder standpoint, what's going to be different this time, if the market changes and things slow down, you know, builders have an outlet with institutional investors where they can sell their way through the rest of their inventory and,
absolutely,
you know, kind of work deals out with these institutional investors that want to rent the houses. So very interesting, you know, different time that we're in now. And especially if the housing market, and when the housing market corrects in terms of the exits that sellers have that weren't there before.
Yeah. Well, what I want to do real quick is just bring up my market. Cause again, I believe all of my students, if you are one of my students watching this, you should take this template, which I will load in the course, and you should do your market. But I thought I would do Fresno as an example. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to copy this little housing logo, just control C, and I'm going to drop it in places where it is changing. So for me, I've already heard in my market that open houses are slowing down, right? Mm-hmm. The agents are going, don't worry, it's summer behavior, all of that. I don't know. But again, I think I've already seen open houses get a lot less traffic just in the last 3 or 4 weeks. Then the other thing that we are seeing already is listings are growing weekly. Again, it starts slow. It starts to grow. But those are the two right now. Again, I think this is going to change and evolve month to month, week to week. But right now we've got 2 of 10. Again, it's going from extreme seller's market and ever so slowly moving back. Everybody should do their own market. So,
well, with those two, I would think your days on market have got to be up by at least 25% or more by now.
Yeah, actually, I did change. I changed that to 50%. I didn't change this. I changed it.
Temporary. I would think that's being affected if you're seeing, you know, these other things already.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just so new, right? These first things I've seen in the last 4 weeks, this number, when I built this, this number would have changed because they're up 25%, but they're not up 50, right? We changed that on the template, right? Yep, we did. Okay. Right. So yeah, I think it's coming, but yeah, this is the whole idea, folks. If you're looking at your market every day, these are the things that are changing. These are the things that should encourage you as an investor to say, oh my God, I'm getting just a little bit more power. It is coming my way. It's not going to be instant. It's not going to be in a day. It's not going to be in a week. It will trickle in, but more of these will expand week by week, month by month, in my opinion. That makes sense?
Yeah, absolutely. And that's what I mean by overnight. Within 30 days, you can see things drastically change in a housing market.
Absolutely. 30 days for sure. Well, Greg, that was a lot of fun. Thank you for playing real estate slowdown bingo is what I think I'm going to call it. This was a lot of fun. I look forward to talking about the dollar next. Thanks, buddy.
Yep.